he comes striding across the yard.
Oh, that I beat her up and stole her car.
And I knew he was mad, but you could tell by the look on his face.
I've had people call me from all over threatening me.
And he says, who told you you could come to my house, you know?
I never had anything to do with the car.
And then he just started punching her through my windows. So down about, you know, like to there.
This lady's done this many times to other people.
I did call the police.
I really don't even care.
They couldn't arrest her as a misdemeanor.
We aren't friends anymore.
Oh, they're not my friends. Never again in life.
Back from treating Ebola patients in West Africa, this Stanford doctor has become the first person in California to be under quarantine. The doctor has shown no symptoms of the deadly disease.
But tonight he tells us why he's not taking any chances. Ann Notarangelo is live in Palo Alto with what the doctor can and can't do. Ann?
And Dr. Colin Bucks is taking his temperature every day. He's contacting the San Mateo County Health Department twice a day so that they can monitor his health. But as you said, he is showing absolutely no signs of Ebola. But the doctor just returned from Liberia last week, and when he arrived back, there were no guidelines. So now he is starting the 21-day quarantine. But when he got here, they decided to pull together their resources. What should they do? They came up with this. They came up with that he should not go to work for 3 weeks. He should limit all of his personal contact for 3 weeks. They did concede that they'd let him go jogging once a day as long as he was alone. So he's always been monitored ever since he got back from Liberia. But what is new is this quarantine. He told KPIX 5 this afternoon by phone, "I'm California's most experienced Ebola physician. I won't take a single chance. My wife is away. My dog is away. There's no downside, but a little personal inconvenience, and 3 weeks will pass." Now, he spent a little over a month in Liberia working with the International Medical Corps, working directly with Ebola patients. Here's Dr. Bucks in a New York Times video talking about the work being done in West Africa.
And also this is a medical public health emergency. When I saw the news of the outbreak occurring, it wasn't really so much whether I would go, it was how and in what capacity.
So Dr. Bucks gets that there might be some hysteria. At least there is concern over the Ebola and the concept of Ebola. But he does say that he does believe that the CDC is doing a great job, and he applauds their efforts. At Stanford, Ann Notarangelo, KPIX 5.
California is now the latest state to order quarantines for travelers who came in close contact with Ebola patients in West Africa. New protocols issued today require county health officials to evaluate people on a case-by-case basis. The amount of contact a traveler had with Ebola patients will affect their type of quarantine. It could range from observation and monitoring to the limitation of movement.
President Obama says there could be more cases of the Ebola virus diagnosed here in the U.S. in the weeks to come.
We can't hermetically seal ourselves off. The nature of international travel and movement means that the only way to assure that we are safe is to make sure that we have dealt with the disease where right now it is most acute.
The president thanked doctors and healthcare workers who joined the fight in West Africa. He says government policies to stop the spread of Ebola in the U.S. should be based in science and not fear. Well, the U.S. military is taking extra precautions. Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel approved plans to keep troops returning from Ebola response missions in 21-day quarantines. Now, that would apply to the more than 1,000 U.S. troops who are currently helping in the fight against Ebola. Meantime, a nurse in Maine who treated Ebola patients in West Africa says she will not follow her quarantine orders. Casey Hickok says that she is showing no symptoms and plans to take herself out of quarantine tomorrow. Maine officials are in the process of filing court orders to keep her in isolation. Hickox was the first person forced into New Jersey's mandatory quarantine.
There are questions tonight as to what caused dozens of people at an NAACP convention in Redwood City to get violently ill after dinner. These photos are from the dinner on Saturday night at the Sofitel Hotel. Everyone looks fine, but that would soon change. The next morning, as many as 100 people were sick after eating the salmon and salad. Some even had to go to the hospital.
Los Angeles chapter was throwing up. Hollywood chapter was throwing up. And as we start talking to people, a lot of older people was in their rooms throwing up, couldn't get out the bed.
The San Mateo County Health Department says it is interviewing those who went to the hospital. So far, it hasn't been able to pinpoint the cause.
The Giants are going to try to do something tonight that has not been done in 35 years. Win Game 7 of the World Series on the road. KPIX5's Ryan Takeo is at Civic Center Plaza. A huge crowd hoping to witness history. They were denied last night, Ryan, maybe tonight.
Maybe tonight. Yeah, last night didn't go so well, but the crowd is here. They're ready. Game 7 just moments away. Most in the crowd here, they're feeling good about the Giants' chances. Some are worried, though, because the Giants, they didn't score last night at all. Shut out in Game 6. Now, no matter the outcome, the police focus is on crowd control. The goal here is not to repeat what's gone wrong in previous championship runs.
Come on. Game 7.
Giants fans are ready for the World Series decisive game. The celebration, they're confident, will follow.
We're going to be ready for our team. You'll see. We're coming.
In years past, that celebrating has turned into violence. Police arrested 36 after the last championship in 2012. Some set fires in the streets, even smashed a Muni bus.
It's really sad. You know, it was really sad to see, just the destruction that people did last time we won in 2012.
One kid in the mission hopes it doesn't happen again. Here's the note he wrote and posted on his neighborhood Popeyes.
It says, "I love the Giants. I want the Giants to win.
Please don't hurt my neighborhood. I get scared."
Joey, 6 years old. Okay. Wow. Right on, Joey.
Those who saw the full-page handwritten note say there were a couple posted around the Mission neighborhood trying to appeal to rowdy fans. San Francisco Police's plan to keep fans at bay includes picking up trash cans ahead of time and having gas buses replace buses on power lines to avoid rioters. Eric hopes the fact the team's been here before will help fans too.
We hope we've matured a little bit. You know, I mean, I think the first couple of years people were just caught off guard with excitement, didn't know how to act.
All hands on deck for SFPD. Same thing too for the Giants bullpen, including ace Madison Bumgarner. He's available after just starting on Saturday, Ken. Rather, Sunday.
Yeah, let's hope for the best tonight. It's one and done, man. There's no tomorrow. Ryan, thank you for that.
This is it.
Well, a Bay Area school board candidate just learned a valuable lesson about cheating. Amy Moss is running for a seat in Walnut Creek District. She admits she was caught in the act, trying to swipe a rival's campaign sign Monday night. The sign promoting Sherry McCoff was posted on someone's house. McCoff says that she put it back when the homeowner spotted her. Moss told the Contra Costa Times she's deeply ashamed and has apologized to all her fellow candidates, but at this point, she has no plans to withdraw from the race.
Other Bay Area headlines, 38-year-old Manuel Cedillo was the social worker assigned to help a 16-year-old girl. Now he's behind bars for allegedly molesting her. The Santa Clara resident faces several felony counts of child molestation. When the victim reported to authorities, she had been having sex with him. Cedillo was already on administrative leave for another alleged inappropriate relationship.
Berkeley police looking for whoever shot and killed a man near the marina last night. Witnesses reported hearing several gunshots and seeing two suspects fleeing the scene. Officers found the victim's body near the Seabreeze Market. They also discovered a gun and several bullets.
A transformer fire brought down power lines in San Jose. It happened about 10 a.m. at Florence and Lindale Avenues. This knocked out power to about 3,500 customers. About 250 are still without electricity. PG&E expects to have it restored by 10 p.m. A welcome sight on the launch pad in Cape Canaveral today.
Two and liftoff of the United Launch Alliance Atlas V rocket carrying the 8th GPS.
This unmanned cargo rocket launched without a hitch, boosting a $245 million GPS satellite into space. In the meantime, our Sharon Chin tells us NASA is still trying to sort out yesterday's catastrophic failure in Virginia. Sharon?
Liz, today's successful launch came just hours after an unmanned supply rocket blew up on takeoff from Wallops Island.
Hold on. Hold on. Hold on. It's going to be loud.
The unmanned rocket belonged to Orbital Sciences. NASA pays the private company billions of dollars to make space station deliveries. Investigators are hoping debris on the ground will provide some clues about what went wrong, and they're warning everyone else not to touch it.
If you find anything that washes ashore in the local area or came down on your farm or in your yard, contact the local authorities and definitely do not touch it.
No one was hurt, but more than 5,000 pounds of supplies for the International Space Station were destroyed, along with dozens of student science experiments. Some came from right here in the Bay Area. Students at Mark West Charter School in Santa Rosa spent months last year designing their project. They were testing whether shrimp-like triops could survive a space launch and potentially be used as a food source for astronauts. But as you saw, their hard work went up in flames. One student told us last night it was still a great learning experience. In the newsroom, Sharon Chin, KPIX 5.
Well, we have developing news right now. People in one Hawaiian village on the Big Island preparing to, you know, sit back and watch their homes burn to the ground. Brian Hackney joins us with a look at the molten lava that has already reached the edge of that town, Brian.
As in Pahoa about 20 years ago, nice little village. Dozens of people tonight are watching this disaster play out. In slow motion, the lava continually creeping up to the small town of Pahoa. Now it's just yards away from burning through the first of several homes.
The relentless flow of lava steadily searing its way toward Pahoa swallowed up this shed on the edge of the village and is threatening to do the same to dozens more. Moving quickly, it's charred through miles of thick brush at about 15 yards an hour. There is nothing that can stop it. Hundreds have been evacuated, making the decision to leave their homes and save themselves.
They're obviously very sad because they love where they live.
This particular lava flow began back in June after the eruption of the Kilauea volcano and is now closing in on one of Pahoa's main roads. People here have had weeks to prepare, but still find themselves overwhelmed.
Pretty heartbreaking. It's pretty sad, yeah. We don't know what's going to happen from now on.
In an effort to help residents find some comfort, officials are allowing people to actually witness the lava destroying their own homes. They hope that it might bring about some sense of closure.
The initial shock was like you're losing a person, like a loved one in your family.
It's grim. If the lava burns through several homes, it could make its way down to the ocean. It has before. It could do it again. And if it does, it will have blocked all the main roads leading into town, which could make it very difficult for residents to get in or out. Geologists also warn of possible explosions because of the dangerous mix of 2,000-degree temperatures and gas from the lava flow. Liz?
Wow. Imagine people watching their homes burn right in front of them. Unbelievable. All right, Brian, thank you.
Okay.
Well, it's the internet upgrade that will make your life easier.
HTML5 is designing for the future of how we use the internet.
How it's already changing what you can do on the web.
Well, that is not your typical BART train. How Las Vegas inspired a convenient new ride to the airport.
And the Red Cross at the center of its own PR disaster. What dozens of empty trucks were reportedly doing instead of helping Hurricane Sandy victims. New at 5, getting to the Oakland Airport is about to get a whole lot easier. The BART connector from the Coliseum Station could be up and running within weeks. Our Don Ford went behind the scenes for a sneak peek.
Listen, do you hear that? Actually, you don't, because these new BART cars are unlike anything BART has ever used before. Very quiet. They are specially made for the new BART to Oakland Airport connector.
They don't have motors and brake systems on the vehicle. They're actually all propelled by a cable system.
Like cable
so it's
cars?
Like a high-tech cable car, right.
But no gripman, not even a driver. A computer tells the vehicle when to grab the cable and when to let go. The entire trip will be monitored by remote cameras. And that quiet ride? It's because the system runs on these rubber tires across a smooth, flat steel track.
This is exactly the same as the rail they have in Las Vegas between the hotels.
Oh.
Right, so I actually went down and tried that out.
She insists it was market research. The rail here is about 3 miles long and cost about $484 million to build. That's about $30,000 a foot. You paid for it, but each trip on the train will cost you another $6. For the next few weeks, BART will be testing this system, and you'll see these cars passing over the top of 880. They hope to start real passenger service sometime before Thanksgiving. In Oakland, Don Ford, KPIX5.
Well, this project has been more than four decades in the making. The first feasibility study was conducted back in 1970.